Okay, so the reader's writer's problem, we have a buffer, a shared buffer that that is accessed by multiple processes, reading and writing. The issue here is not the size of the buffer. The issue is controlling access to the buffer among readers and writers. If you have a writer writing to the buffer, then you don't want any other writers to be writing at the same time, because if other writers are allowed to be writing at the same time, you will be having, you will potentially have conflicting conflicts between these two writers. Only one writer should have access to the buffer. So a writer should have exclusive access to the buffer. Now, if you have a reader in the buffer, if a reader is reading from the buffer, there is no problem if we allow other readers to be reading. So you can have any number of readers reading at the same time, and there is no issue, there is no conflict. Okay? So you can have one writer or one or more readers. So how can we do this? We will do this using two semaphores, two mutex semaphores, and one shared variable. The shared variable is read count, which counts the number of readers in the buffer. Right, and we'll see in a minute how we use this. And the mutex semaphore, there are two mutex semaphores. The main semaphore is the RW semaphore, the RW mutex semaphore, that ensures that in the buffer is either in read mode or in write mode. If it's in write mode, you can have only one writer. If it's in read mode, you can have as many readers as you want. So this is the main semaphore that controls access between readers and writers. And there is an R mutex semaphore that simply protects access to the shared variable read count. So R mutex semaphore has the sole purpose of protecting this shared variable. Okay, now let's look at how this works. On the writer side, things are very simple. The writer will just, you know, writing should be protected by the RW mutex semaphore. So the writer should check on the RW mutex semaphore. If it's zero, of course, what should the initial value of this semaphore be? Like any mutex semaphore. The initial value of any mutex semaphore is? No, it's one. It's initially available. For any mutex semaphore, if it's zero, then no one will access the buffer. A mutex semaphore is initially available, which means the initial value should be one. It's initialized to one, and the R mutex only dependence semaphores are maybe initialized to zero. But when you have dependence, and your objective is to block one process until another process is done doing something, then you want to initialize it to zero to make the resource unavailable initially. Then, when the dependency is satisfied, you post it and you make it one. But with mutex semaphores, it's the other way around. You initialize it with a one. So when the writer finds this one, if this is one, the writer can proceed and do the writing. If it's zero, the writer will wait. So this is very straightforward. Now on the reader side, things are trickier because we can have multiple readers. Okay. Now on the reader side, now I will describe what happens, then we will understand why. So first let's understand what the reader does. What the reader does is that it first waits on the R mutex semaphore, which protects access to this shared variable. Then it increments it. It's saying that, you know, I'm a reader, so I'm incrementing the number of readers in the buffer. Then it checks on read count. If it's one, it's going to wait on the RW mutex semaphore. And then it's going to release the R mutex semaphore. And when the reader does the reading. And when it's done, again, it's going to decrement read count, And access to read count is protected by this R mutex semaphore. Then it's going to check on read count. If it's zero, it's going to signal the RW mutex semaphore. Now, in order for this to make sense, we need to understand why the reader checks on read count. If it's one, it waits on the RW mutex semaphore. What's the logic here? Why, if read count equals one, the reader checks on the RW mutex semaphore, and if read is not one, it's not going to check on the RW mutex semaphore. Okay, so let me ask the question in a different way. What we are saying here, if read count equals one, the reader will wait on the RW mutex semaphore. So the reader, basically what the reader is doing here, it's checking if there is a writer in the buffer. Right? If there is a writer in the buffer, what will the value of the RW mutex semaphore be? If there is a writer in the buffer, what will the value of this semaphore be?
One.
No, it will be zero. The semaphore counts the number of available instances of a resource. If a writer is in the buffer, then that writer has that single instance of the resource. So when the writer did wait, what does wait do? Wait, if the number of instances of the resource is zero, I'm going to wait. If it becomes one, I'm going to take it and decrement it. Wait decrements. So if there is a writer in the buffer, the value of the RW mutex semaphore is going to be zero. And then the reader will wait, because there is a writer in the buffer. But the question is, why are we doing this only if read count is one? So we're saying that if read count is two or three or four, we're not going to check on the writer. We don't care about the writer. Why? If read count is greater than one, we don't care about the writer. Why?
Because there are people reading?
Yeah, because there are readers. And if there are readers, there can't be a writer. So if I am reader number two or three or four or five, I know that there is a reader already in the buffer. And if there is a reader in the buffer, I know that there are no writers in the buffer. So basically, a reader, the first reader, locks the buffer for all readers. So once a reader manages to access the buffer, then all readers are welcome. Any reader can come in and read from the buffer, because there is only one reader. There are other readers in the buffer. So only the first reader has to worry about checking whether there is a writer in the buffer or not. Okay. Now, when the reader is done, it's going to check if read count equals zero, then I'm releasing the semaphore, the RW mutex semaphore. So releasing or signaling the semaphore means that writers can now access the buffer. Now the question is, why read count equals zero? Why is the condition read count equals zero?
No processes.
Yes, yes.
That means if you're the last reader, you let the writer.
Yeah, exactly. The last reader. So it's basically, you know, the first person to get into the room will turn the lights on, and the last person to leave the room will turn the lights off. So this is the first reader, and this is the last reader. So this is first reader, turns the lights on, and the last reader will turn them off, meaning it will release the buffer, and writers can now access the buffer. Okay? All right, so now, this is not enough. So we need to understand this more deeply. Two important questions. The first question is, we said that in any parallel program, the objective should always be minimizing the size of the critical section, because the critical section is sequential. Only one process can be in the critical section. So we are disabling parallelism in the critical section. So our objective is always minimizing the size of the critical section. This is protected by a semaphore or a lock, so that we maximize parallelism. Because we're doing all of this business in order to get things to run in parallel, right? And if the more, you know, larger critical sections means disabling parallelism for longer periods of time and potentially getting, you know, less benefit or no benefit from parallelism. Now, in an attempt to minimize the size of the critical section, I'm talking here about the critical section of modifying the variable read count. So the critical section that modifies the variable read count is what is between the weight and the signal. The weight, critical section, signal. So this critical section here has three lines in it. Read, check if read is one, wait. Three lines. So I'm going to make an attempt to minimize the size of the critical section by limiting the critical section to only incrementing read count. Because all what I need here is to make sure that when a process is incrementing read count, no other process is touching this shared variable. So in an attempt to minimize the size of the critical section, I'm going to move signal to this point between the read and the if. So I'm going to put the if read count equals 1 outside of the critical section. So this will reduce the size of the critical section from 3 to 1. But will this work correctly or not? Will it work correctly or not? And why? Any idea if it's going to work correctly or not? So
no.
It will not work. Why not?
Well, because when another process is increment the count, another process reading may be reading the old value.
Reading the old value of what? Of
counter.
Counter. Yeah, and what happens if a process reads an old value? Can you describe a scenario in which a disaster may happen? Okay, so the scenario in which a disaster may happen is reader number one. You have reader number one increments the count. So the counter is originally zero. The count, the read count equals zero. Reader number one changes this to one. But then reader number one, after changing this to one, it gets interrupted. It loses the CPU before it checks on the value of read count. So reader number one loses the CPU, or then loses CPU. Then reader number two arrives, and then it will increment the value of the counter. It will change it to two. Now, what will happen when reader number one gets the CPU again?
It checks if it's one.
So it will check if it's one. What will it find it? It will find it two. So what will it do? Yeah, it will go into the buffer without checking if there is a writer or not. So in this scenario, none of the readers is going to check if there is a writer or not. None of them is going to execute this, because read count will never be one, right? It was one at some point, but the process that incremented that to one lost the CPU before it did the check, okay? But if we put the incrementation and the checking inside the critical section, this will not happen. This will not happen. In fact, well, let's explain again. Let's make sure that we understand precisely what we mean here. So we're saying that if we, with this, the way it's written now, with this inside of the critical section, the process that is doing this will not get interrupted. Does this mean that we are guaranteed that if a process is in its critical section, it will not lose the CPU? Does the operating system guarantee that if a process is in its critical section, it will not lose the CPU?
No.
No, it doesn't guarantee. What does the OS guarantee in this case?
No.
What does it guarantee then?
random process can access.
Process can access the critical section.
No other process will access this this particular critical section, right? So the operating system is not saying that if you put these in the critical section, I'm guaranteeing that you will get the CPU, you will keep the CPU until you complete this. No, the operating system is guaranteeing you that if you are in this critical section, any process that attempts to access a critical section that is protected by our mutex, is going to get blocked. I'm going to block any process that is waiting on our mutex. Because simply, you know, the value of our mutex is going to be zero. Right? So the semaphore is just a shared variable that is managed by the operating system itself. It's a shared variable that is managed by the OS itself. And any process that is attempting to access this is going to get blocked.
Yeah.
Basically here, what we are learning here is that when you have a shared variable, that is, when you have code that modifies a shared variable, then checks on the value of that shared variable and takes an action based on the value of a shared variable, you better protect the update and the checking with semaphores or locks. So you, your critical section must include both the checking, the modification of the shared variable, and the checking on that shared variable. So you don't want to get interrupted in the middle of, after modification but before checking, because you may be checking on a different value. Okay, now the more serious problem with this solution is starvation. So we have a serious starvation problem. Where is the starvation problem here, and who would starve, readers or writers? The question is this solution biased towards readers or writers? When you understand this solution, is it like writer-friendly or user-friendly? Is it biased towards readers or writers? Who are being privileged here?
Writers.
Readers are being privileged. Why?
Because all of them can go after the first
one. Yeah, because once a reader gets the buffer, all the readers in the world can access the buffer, and there is no limit. So the scenario is this. You have reader number one arrives and locks the buffer. Then writer arrives. Now when the writer arrives, it's going to be waiting on which semaphore? The RW semaphore. Then, now writer is in the queue. It's in the queue for the RW semaphore. It's, you know, we have a queue, and this queue has the writer waiting in the queue. Then, reader number two arrives. What will happen? Will it wait on the semaphore?
No.
No, it will just go to the buffer. No. Access the buffer. And then reader number three just access the buffer. And reader number four will access the buffer. And reader number a million will access the buffer. So this is what we mean by unbounded waiting. So this poor writer is waiting, and readers keep arriving, and we're not setting any limit on the number of readers, on the number of other processes that are accessing the resource while this process is waiting. So this is, you know, this is what we mean by unbounded waiting. So starvation is equivalent to unbounded waiting. Okay, question?
So the writers get starved then?
Yeah, so in this case, yeah, the writers can starve. So it's this solution is biased towards readers, and writers can starve. So this is the process that is starving. Okay? Now,
so in this case, the writers are starving or readers?
Writers, yeah, so readers are privileged, so they are not. You know, an unlimited number of readers is arriving, and the writers are starving. So, you know, if we ask, you know, Is this solution biased towards readers or writers? It's biased towards readers. Who would starve writers? Okay, so writers would may starve. Now the question is, how do we resolve this? How can we resolve this? But there is a simpler solution that is equally fair to readers and writers. In other words, it will give this writer the buffer before any of the readers that arrive afterwards. So it will just treat all processes equally by simply introducing one semaphore that all processes wait for. So if you introduce yet another semaphore that everyone will have to wait on, then you are treating all processes equally. And any process, whether it's a reader or a writer, will have to wait on that semaphore before doing anything. So if we call that the fairness semaphore, we will end up with this solution. So this is on the reader side, on the writer side. Wait on fairness, then wait on RW, then signal fairness. So this is a fairness that everyone will have to wait on. Then, on the reader side, again, every reader will have to wait on fairness before doing all of this, you know, R mutex and incrementing the read count and all of this business. Then it's going to signal fairness. Now, this way, we are forcing everyone to stand in line. The main problem with the original solution is that readers never had to stand in line. Readers could go straight to the buffer if there is at least one reader in the buffer. So what caused the problem, or what caused the starvation, is that readers, at least, you know, readers 2 and 3 and 4, all readers except the first reader, did not have to stand in line, did not have to be put in any queue. But now with this fairness semaphore, we're putting all processes in a queue. So now with this, let me explain how this works. So now with this scenario, when reader number one arrives, it's going to lock the buffer. It will find all semaphores available, and it will lock the buffer. No problem for R1. So R1 now will be reader number one will be reading the buffer, will be on this line. When the writer arrives, what will the value of fairness be? 0 or 1? 1. It will be 1, because reader released it. Reader number one released the fairness before it started reading. Okay, reader number one released, signaled the fairness semaphore before it started reading. So now when writer arrives, it will find fairness 1, so it will not have to wait on fairness, because it's the second in line. So this way it will have priority over any reader that will arrive later. So the writer will look at RW mutex, what will the value of that be? If there is a reader,
0.
It will be 0. So the writer will be waiting here. Now, when the second reader arrives, it will check on fairness. What will the value of fairness be?
0. 0,
because it's locked by the writer. So now reader number two will have to wait on fairness. It will be blocked here, and it will not do this business. So the writer will get the buffer before reader number two. Okay? Does this make sense? Of course, you know, this is not necessary. You know, this looks fair, but fairness is not necessarily, it's not always the objective. Because there is an advantage in allowing, you know, multiple readers to be in the buffer, or in giving a priority to readers, or in being biased towards readers. So fairness is not necessarily our objective all the time. Right? So we're just describing two different solutions. One solution that is biased towards readers. It allows an unlimited number of readers to be in the buffer even if a writer is waiting, and a perfectly fair solution that will make everyone stand in line, and it will be fair to all processes. And only if a reader is in the buffer, reader number two will not get the buffer until the writer is done. Thank you.